afternoon. So they hate you if you're clever and despise a fool till you're so fucking crazy you can't follow their rules. A working class hero is something to be. These words inspired my talk today. They were written by John Lennon almost 50 years ago. And every time I hear these words, it feels like a punch in the stomach. It's not just thought-provoking, it's a punch in the stomach. And the reason for that is that I can relate to the experience that Lennon describes of growing up in a system that wants you to be just right. Not too right, not wrong, just right. Please paint between the lines that we drew for you. And the fact of the matter is, if you stay too long in such systems, what happens is when you leave, you look for supporting organizational structures that reward and recognize what I call a mindset of exclamation marks, meaning knowing is much more important than asking. And I want to talk to you a bit about the dangers of such a mindset, because I think it's a very dangerous thing when you live inside an organization. And I think most of us live in such organizations. I live in such. Mine is called Amdocs. We are a software company, the biggest provider of services in the world for the telecommunication company. And we also, like any other very big and successful organization, foster a mindset of knowing rather than asking. Right? But being part of the innovation team, my job, among others, is to make sure that we systematically question everything that we think we know. And the reason for that is, if you practice a mindset of exclamation marks long enough, it becomes a second nature. It becomes automatic. And when that happens, the most unnatural and terrifying thing that can happen to you is not knowing. And I want to talk a bit about the terror of not knowing, because this is something that you find in organizations. Right? People in organizations like mine are terrified of not knowing. So in the face of terror, I noticed a phenomenon which I call asking an answer. Asking an answer happens when you ask an answer with already a ready-made answer in the back of your mind. It might be intuitive, it might be latent. In some cases, we actually put the answer inside the question, making sure we come to the discussion with an answer. I'll give you an example in my corporate surrounding. You'll probably hear someone ask, how can we secure a competitive edge in the next 5 years using our AI platform? So notice two things about this question. One, the answer is already there, right? The future is AI, we know that, everybody says so, even our CEO. And second, here's the crazy part. We know that we have absolutely no idea what is coming for us 5 years from now. The reason we know that is we've been here 5 years ago and we didn't have a clue that this is where we'll be today. But we keep on creating these false exclamation marks. Basically, that's the only way you can face the future, or else you're paralyzed. And that's why I love exclamation marks. They're efficient and they create a sense of security, even though it's false. And it might be good enough if you're exploring the present, but if you're exploring the future, if you're leading innovation, that can kill your organization. And the reason for that is that organizations that explore their future with exclamation marks are destined to relive their past, basically because exclamation marks were made in the past, right? So if I'm exploring my future with the past, I'm basically destined to relive it, and the past is not a bright future. But wait, it gets even more frustrating. Because the fact of the matter is, the more experience and knowledge you have in the organization, the more challenging it is to identify that the reality is changing. Because organizations, much like people, suffer from what is called educated incapacity. Meaning the more knowledge we have about the world, the more experience, the less we're able to identify when the world is changing. And that's very easy to explain. Our concepts about the world are changing much slower than the world itself. Right? So, I mean, we live in a world that is changing at an exponential pace. We as humans seldom do. And that creates a perpetual gap between ourselves and the reality that we think is out there than what is actually out there. But wait, it gets even more frustrating. Because the fact of the matter is, it doesn't even matter how smart you are. Right? So, you can accumulate as much IQ as you can find in the organization, take a lot of really smart people, and still lose sight of what's coming. So there's a certain research, a new research, that shows that IQ can predict your success in your job only after 2 years. After 2 years, it can't predict your success in your job. Why? Because things change, right? So if I want to recap, and I'm saying IQ will not help you cope with everything that's changing, I want to recap and say, we're terrified of not knowing, being experienced is not enough, and being smart doesn't help, so what's the alternative? Right? So Amin Tufani, who's a researcher from the Singularity University, talks about something that he calls AQ, and that is adaptability quotient. Basically, the core capability of organizations and people like us, like you, to adapt to what's happening out there. Basically, what Tufani is saying, and this is a strong statement, is that in a reality that, again, is changing exponentially, your ability to adapt is far more important than what you know. So organizations need to develop this as a core capability with themselves and with their employees. If you ask Tufani, this is such a strategic initiative that any organization should have a chief adaptability officer leading this effort as a strategic effort. But here comes the good news, right? The news you've been waiting for. The good news is that AQ is a learned quality, much more than IQ. Meaning you can unlearn your exclamation marks and you can relearn asking new questions. And that's a good thing, right? So we at Amdocs, we still don't have a chief adaptability officer, not yet anyway. But we have a couple of best practices that help us to explore the future and lead innovation. And I want to share with you three of them today very, very briefly. I want to talk a bit about how we ask questions and why working with assumption is so critical and why encouraging learnings might be more important than encouraging success. And I'll start with the first. So we know that we need to ask questions with curiosity and empathy. Basically, design thinking teaches that, but we don't really do that. The reason for that is when it comes to organizations, everything that we ask our customers are designed to sell, not to understand. The reason we do that is because we keep on asking questions that we have the answers to, right? Because we're asking answers. So we found that we need to broaden the lines of communication with our customers and ask questions that we don't have answers to, answer questions that will surprise us, right? Questions that we don't have the answers to, and I would admit it is a terrifying experience. But we also understand that without learning, we can provide value. And funny enough, our customers understand that as well. So we keep on asking questions that we assume and we hope will surprise us. Second, work with your assumptions, don't hide them. So in their book, Discovery-Driven Growth, McGrath and Macmillan write, in corporate organizations, assumptions are treated as facts and are buried inside the working plan. That is a very powerful statement. I feel obligated to say it again. In corporate organizations, assumptions are treated as facts and are buried inside the working plan. I mean, why do we do that? Why do we bury our assumptions? Or, better yet, put it on a slide and then forget about it once we get green light and budget for execution? I'll give you a hint. Assumptions force us to admit that we don't know. We assume. And what do we feel about not knowing, right? So we found that there are two things that enable you to work with your assumptions. One is a systematic approach, right? Systematic approach of identifying, prioritizing, validating your assumptions, making sure that you focus on the riskiest assumptions first. And the Lean Startup, which we discussed here earlier, offers a lot of practical tools. We developed the Nest, which is our IP, our best practice around Lean Startup. It's basically based on the corporate startup and the Lean Startup, very recommended books. But that's not the challenge. The challenge comes from the second component, and that is legitimacy. Legitimacy in saying, I don't know that. I assume that. So why don't we validate it before we start building it? So we work with individuals and teams and managers to create this sense of legitimacy, helping them to say, really, I'm really good at what I do, but I don't know that. We haven't done that before. And last but not least, encouraging learning. So here's the thing, guys. If people are measured by success alone, they are forced to be right all of the time. Yes, they're not right all of the time, but they're forced to be right all of the time. And when that happens, learning is a luxury. But basically, learning is the only way an organization can expand its potential. So we found that alongside measuring success, which is important, we should also measure learnings. We should measure experiments and their successes and the conclusions that came out of it. This is part of our path to success. So I want to recap a bit what I talked about in the last 10 minutes. Don't be afraid of not knowing. Any other way of exploring the future is false and ungenuine. Ask questions with curiosity. I warn you, it will be terrifying, but this is the only way you can learn and provide value to others. And last but not least, adaptability will determine your future as a person and your organization. You need to develop it as a core capability. And if I want to revert back to the headline of my talk today, I really believe that we need to force ourselves and to support others in not drawing between the lines, but paint beautiful paintings with passion and curiosity and creativity, because I truly believe that our future will be designed by painters. Thank you for having me.